you can look at that. What I need councillors to do is see what they feel, because you know your local areas, and you'll know if there's a problem or something can be done, or something alternative that could be done, or something can't be done. I mean, that's the kind of information Simon needs now. So with him insisting that the mayor fund something, but then local councillors turn around and say, like, John, we don't want our residents, we don't want that. So I believe you do want this for a sense check at this stage. I think the principle that something will happen and it, we will be progressing with it is definitely happening, and I'm massively excited for his work on it.
We've already had a discussion around the primary debate. And, you know, residents actually firmly believed when it was first mooted that the cycle lane would go past their drive and they'd not be able to get out of their drive. Well, let's have a better discourse. You know, let's, rather than going about it, our council normally goes about it in a very clumsy manner of saying, here's what we're doing. We could actually say, what would you like us to do? This is what we're thinking of doing. What do you think of it? And then allaying any fears. But at the same time, there's a carrot and there's a stick as well, you know, because to my mind, the first thing I would have done in school is given all the children pollution monitors and done a study on it, and then said, and now what we want to do is reduce parking outside. Look at the difference when the drop-off isn't happening. Go and tell your parents that. But so it's both, really. It is a discourse, but I agree with Lawrence as well that at some point, and I've been told this from the top as well, at some point you do have to do things which initially will be unpopular.
Okay, thank you very much. I have a question as well, which kind of links in with this. It's more for Laura, and it is around infrastructure. Obviously, it links in very much that this idea that we need infrastructure for the cycling in order for things to happen. Yeah. So, and therefore for the people to change their behavior. So in terms of Liverpool City Centre connectivity scheme, obviously, in terms of its scheme, how does it impact the environment? Because in a way, some of my North End residents are quite upset about no bus links cross city in front of the Lime Street, and that's something that's quite upsetting to people, but also, in a way, yes, it will be less polluted, I understand, in front of the Lime Street in terms of that particular area, but then if the buses are not going there, there will be more pollution elsewhere, so in a way, mitigating pollution in one place and then in the other. How do we manage that? But this cross-city link as well is quite important, so that's one issue that I have. And another question, since I have a list of questions, please, others, then jump in as well. It's also connected, so I will just ask that as well. In terms of clean air zone, you know, when is that actually going to come into action? There's been lots of media attention on Manchester, and I saw that 2021 is going to be a date when we're going to have fines there issued in Manchester, so when are we going to be having fines, and basically, when are the diesel vehicles, which are polluting the air the most, going to be banned from the city? So those are my set of questions.
Thank you, Chair, for those easy questions. With regards to the city centre connectivity scheme, that is obviously a very long-term scheme. We originally applied for the funding 4 or 5 years ago now. And the idea behind it is that it improves air quality and reduces congestion. It's a very complex scheme and it involves lots of different bits of the city, lots of different roads and multi-million pounds worth of investment in infrastructure. It's not necessarily the case that everyone always agrees how you do things and how you best do things, and obviously things have changed sort of quite recently, not only with climate emergency, but of course we had our flyover tank down, so there's been a lot of important change in the meantime. I did say that I had some concerns around what was being planned for Lime Street, whether that was being looked at the moment, and I'm glad that it's being looked at. And obviously, the specifics of what you do now are very important, so we need to get that right. So I do think we need to keep raising that. Certainly, I think there's a report at the Regeneration Committee on Thursday, and the office is directly responsible for it. I was not invited to sign up to that report, so it's been important as an environment report, it's a highways report. But obviously we have discussed that communally, and it is continuing in discourse, but you may want to link that with other and other officers.
Okay, and
the clean air zone, we're about managed to were officially ahead of us, but luckily Blaine's here to tell you the exact specifics of that.
So yes, you will have seen a lot of communication around Manchester and even previously Leeds. So now we are in what's referred to as the third wave. So effectively the third year of being mandated as a clean air plan for a city. Manchester were at minimum about 12 months ahead of us in terms of getting the resources from Defqus to do their investigation and their evidence gathering as a consequence. And have, as a consequence, undertaken, and part of the reason you will have seen a loss of publicity because they are in the midst of undertaking their statutory consultation, which everyone has to do. We are in the midst of discussing with Defqus the best options for the city in terms of achieving not just compliance, but going beyond compliance, as I've said previously at this committee. So we are continuing to discuss with them. We are gathering more evidence with them about where our problem areas are, what the issues are, and actually how we best resolve them. As I mentioned previously in presentations at this committee, as part of that work, we are looking at the different types of clean air zones. So there are four different types of clean air zones. I think one of the things to stress is to please go back and look at what Manchester are proposing, because they're not necessarily proposing the most stringent type of clean air zone. I think Birmingham have done that in terms of clean air zone D, category D, but for example Leeds have done two consultations. They did not propose a most stringent. So we are in the midst of that process, discussions with Defqus. What I can't give you is an exact timeline, because obviously it's based on the evidence gathering. As Councillor Robertson-Collins said, when we started this work with Defqus, it was prior to us discussing about a climate emergency. And what we are doing with Defqus is actually making sure that our plans around air pollution are basically supporting as well our issue about improving and improving our response to climate change, because the two are not necessarily automatically interlinked. And the reason I say that is with air pollution, the measure is nitrogen dioxide, so NO2. And yes, diesel cars of diesel vehicles, particularly, not just diesel cars, diesel vehicles, have been identified. But one of the things could be for people to move to petrol, which does not necessarily help climate change. So we are in the midst of that discussion. So what I can't give you, Chair, is a timeline. What I can also say is very much is whatever proposals we ultimately agree with Defqus, they will actually be subject to consultation with the public to understand the socioeconomic impact and the business impact. And again, part of our discussions with Defqus are about how we can implement mitigations, so that includes encouraging vehicle change and also travel type change, so encouraging people to public transport, so trains, buses, but also very much active travel, which is part of our plans. Can I just be very clear about something that you've said around banning diesel vehicles? A charging clean air zone does not ban any vehicle. It applies a charge to those vehicles who are not compliant with the pollution level. Just to be clear again for the members of the public, a diesel vehicle that is younger than 2016 actually complies with the current levels at the moment set out for charging clean air zone, and a petrol vehicle that is younger than, I think it's 2009, but don't quote me exactly on that year, but it's an older petrol vehicle, will actually comply with the air pollution levels that are required in charging clean air zone. And obviously there are a number of different types that apply to heavy goods vehicles, light goods vehicles, buses, etc. as well. So I think there's a number of things to take into consideration, and that's the ongoing discussion with Defqus and certainly the Joint Air Quality Unit. So there's a lot of information. People will be aware of the previous presentations. We will be bringing something back to this committee with more detail once we have the evidence gathered, and Defqus are continuing to ask us for further information, because we are a very unique city comparatively.
Thank you very much, and thank you for that clarification that it is about compliance and not actually banning, but how these vehicles are online. I have the Councillor Dunn here, and I have Councillor Brown. Any other Councillor? Okay, again, Councillor Brown, and I have one more question on Laura's report as well.
This is a question to Laura, it's about obviously and it's definitely welcome that the report, so obviously I'm ahead of making things the council will be introducing their plans in May. I think people have read about our plans, they will be released before September. Just in regards to, it looks like the direction that we're going in here is that there's plans to charge, obviously, private vehicles and private lorries and buses that maybe are not on that trip. I was actually listening to Joe Anderson, what you've got to do today, and he mentioned about the next car park will be an electric car park. So basically, there's a question about how that get regulated, the car park, if it is an electric car park. And mainly just an update about the Happy Sleeps, in terms of obviously the proposal that Johansson made to kind of give loans out to happy drivers or whoever rents off of a loan in Cess 8. This is throwing ideas out today. Is Liverpool City Council in a position to maybe do a deal with a car company where residents of Liverpool can get a loan off Liverpool City Council with an interest rate on it, but obviously at a discount by doing a deal with a car company? And just another question as well is in regards to the news about this potential, this consultation maybe now to kind of legalise the e-scooters. I'm just wondering if that does go ahead after the council got any plans like the cycle scheme that's ahead to introduce e-scooters.
Proposals that they've published, they have asked for 143 million.
much to the reply. Councillor Brown and Councillor Brown again.
Thank you, Chair. Just to point out that the Air Quality and Transport Task Group hasn't met yet. We only got members of the task group about a month ago, something like that. Tried for some while now to get a meeting together, but nothing's actually happened yet, which is very disappointing. A lot of issues we've been discussing just over the last 10, 15 minutes could have gone through the task group and been scrutinised to some extent. So we are in a bit of a hole with that. We really need to push that on. I've been trying, but nothing's happened at the moment. We do need to move that on. All parties need to get together. I say not political parties, but everybody, all stakeholders, everybody that's involved in that task group needs to be aware that we need to move on with the scrutiny for that situation. I think, as you pointed out before, there's been no mention of cruise line terminal in this air quality of transport here. That's another thing that we should be looking at as a task group. That's something I mentioned to the when we had our initial meeting over 2 months ago, about 2 months ago now. So, as I said, we do need to move on. You know, I do hope that everybody can pull together and get a meeting arranged very shortly to pick up some of these issues, because obviously things are moving on rapidly there. You know, Councillor Dawkins mentioned certain aspects there with regard to taxes and so forth. We need to look at those issues, see where they're at, and see what possibilities there are to move on.
Chair, Phil, you mentioned in your report about the Urban Green Up project. Were you at the last member of the committee? Well, were you? I think. Yes, he was. There was some discussion and some concern that the Urban Green Up project, which is a great project, by the way, if we have not everyone's aware of it, we had a report about the Urban Green Up project, the European Union funded project to basically green up the environment.
Collections will have to be done by 2023. So I just wonder, is there a possibility all, scope to bring this date forward, maybe with some pilot schemes or something like this?
Always pushing with the issues around opening of
Anfield train station, and obviously are very much aware of the congestion that happens during not just these still imaginary concerts, but also every football match. So that's an issue that we are all working towards to resolve.
Unless we actually sent a steam offer, and we have aged them that if there's any meetings with central governments, with local governments or organisations in regard to the Liverpool price line, that we would wish that we get, as Shrewsbury councillors, that we get invited to the meetings or we get kept updated on the meetings. And we want to, I basically want to go much further than that. I want to get the Anfield councillors around the table with them, and Waverley councillors, and anyone who is affected councillors with that good price line involved in.
Okay, thank you, Laura. And then we have to move on, because if we don't get the agenda, it seems to be talking for a long time.
Yeah, just to reiterate that obviously you can, again, call, you know, maybe Steve Rowland or someone from the CA, which could have to be someone from the City Council, you can invite external partners to be scrutinised here. But also the chair of the scrutiny panel at Liverpool City Region is Liverpool Councillor, so there might be some work that Councillor Crown could do to put something specifically as in his role as chair of scrutiny at the City Region.
Thank you. Okay, so we are going to invite members of the public to ask any of the questions which are to be held on this report. So you're still on the topic of the report that Laura has given. So. Do we have any questions? Yes?
Can we just clarify at what point, because it's sort of loosely links to the report, at what point can we respond to the answers that we've had to our questions?
Okay, that's the written questions, really. Okay, so that's the item on the agenda after this, and what is there? You have received the answers, and we are, as members of this committee, are going over these answers, clarifying anything if need be between us, and then if you have any supplementary questions, you can put them in writing after we agreed the answers.
Okay, it's not a question, it's a response to answers we've had. Is this not
the right
time? Because if we don't have a chance, then I would like to comment about
that. Okay, the written responses, they will not be discussed as such in terms of the answers, except from us as the members to agree them.
Okay, so then I do have a question.
You have a question for this report.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, and you also have a question for the report. No, there is no other. So, as I said in the beginning, this is not a public meeting, but it is a meeting held in public. So, we have an opportunity to be for you to ask questions on the report now, with Laura's agreement. Okay? So, we have two questions.
Yeah, I don't know if it does fit in, but you've talked about aspects of the plan for climate emergency. Are you proposing to have a complete plan that people will see by a certain date?
Yeah.
And do you have any idea, can you tell us what that date would be?
Well, we'll hopefully be at least by the end of the year. Because it's the next municipal year, we're looking at about June, July time.
June, July of this year.
We're having to buy in a resource to help prepare that.
Great, thank you. And the other thing is you've...
One more question?
Just people have mentioned, as we've been discussing, about public involvement. And we wondered whether it wasn't possible to involve the public actually in drawing up the plans initially, rather than just think about consultation after the plan has been. Is there any notion of involving
the residents? I mean, yes, there's also the LCR climate partnership that's been set up now, and of course
Can I just answer this question before we go on? Does it have to be a Liverpool resident?
You do not have to be a Liverpool resident.
Okay, thank you. Please ask the question.
So is that confirmed? You can
ask the question on the report.
Right, look at that one. Right, my question is actually nothing to do with what you might think. Councillor Dunn quite rightly brought up pollution, and I think in terms of cycling, pollution is a big problem, isn't it? Well, what I've done, and I've spoken to Johnny Hyam, who's doing some work with pollution, and I've done a complete database on all networks, which are the ones that give 24/7 information on PM2.5s and 10s. They're the ones that kill people. Right? And what I've noticed, and I think this would be really important for your committee, is that the Conservatives, and I'm not being political, since 2010 have closed down over 100 all networks in this country. And I have mapped them and done a database. You will not be surprised to know that most of them are in city centres and near highly polluted roads. Three of them, 28,000 cars an hour. Others, 30,000 cars an hour. And this is why I want to refer to Liverpool. And I'm not blaming the council, but the government have closed down two all networks in the city centre and one in Queen's Drive. And we absolutely need to do, I can give you my database, but it would be really important for the council to discuss that. Sorry it wasn't a question, but it was just important.
Your contribution. Okay, thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Can I just point out that in terms of being in the sector, the worst place actually being for pollution is your town.
Okay.
Not walking aside.
Yes. Yes, and we have our third question
from
the member of public, and then we will have to move on.
I have asthma, and when I come in the city centre, it makes it worse. I just wanted to ask what you're specifically doing about the air pollution problem in the city centre.
As members have looked all of these questions, do you have I have a few as well. So first, Councillor Brown, please.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, I've got two questions that I've raised here. The first one is about fields in trust, which I understood the arrangements had been agreed with the announcements that had been agreed with the council. So it says here that any decision of the nature will be subject to a future cabinet report. Does the cabinet member know when that will be presented to the cabinet and when that decision will be taken, so that I can inform residents? And secondly, on the arrangement, the contract arrangement with which is cycling, it does say that the primary purpose of the partnership was to bring mass participation events such as Skyride to the city, and that was a very popular way of people being introduced into cycling and attracted a lot of children because it was on closed roads. Would such a mass participation event still be taking, or is that now being discounted? It's not clear.
Well, that was externally funded, and we asked that external fund for cycling. I totally agree with you, it was a great event. I believe we were both on events that we used to start in our ward. So if there's any funding for it, then brilliant, but I don't know if there isn't, which is why it stopped. And as to the cabinet on parks was, I don't know the answer, there's no concrete answer to that, like I said. So maybe anything.
Okay,
that's
all
done. I think it's just one of the questions that in regards to the section 106 money, I've got a book filter and she's actually in the pot.
That is reported to Neighbours Committee, isn't it? So there's also a report going to Cabinet on Friday. So if you can't report in it, but it's also specifically reported to Neighbours.
Yeah.
One of the chairs just left.
Actually,
you should know the answer to that. There is a report on Friday going to this week's cabinet.
Okay, any other members? Because I have some notes here as well. Okay, so having looked over these questions and answers, I'd just like to note that obviously hydrogen is an issue that you have to keep thinking about. I know that there's a motion that is coming as well to this committee, so you know it is not as straightforward as it might seem that just transferring to Hydrogen City, because obviously from this question it's clear that you know there are bigger considerations around this. So that's something I think that we would ask cabinet members to keep thinking about. That in terms of the question number three, which was addressing builders and developers in the city, and how are we dealing with that? That all these buildings are actually compliant with the climate emergency. I was just wondering, is there a scope for some kind of a climate impact assessment, possibly, that the council could bring into Liverpool local plan? That seems to be, in my way of thinking, forward. And we could maybe address that. And then I have a last issue, and that is on question number six. I'll just say it all, and then maybe you can respond together and not waste time. And that is around, there was an issue here in terms of one, that what we are asking for, and I think the question already came here, around deliverable outputs and targets, and that would be definitely something that we would need to see as this select committee that are scrutinizing the work of cabinet member and the Liverpool City Council. So that would be something to put forward. If not in our next committee, definitely is something, as we are reaching for that 1 year since we declared climate emergency, some kind of a roadmap, a strategy. And also reading through the answer, just a second, because there was a climate change strategy and climate resilience strategy update, and we have Liverpool City Council carbon emission measured in 2017, and kind of where are we now with measuring those carbon emissions. So that would be very important, I feel, from that question. Seems to me that those are crucial issues for this panel, for this committee, in terms of scrutiny as to where we are with those achievement targets. So those are my comments on the public questions, if you would like to respond, maybe.
Not got any of those sort of questions either then, but thank you. With regard to just all of it, really, I mean, obviously, I don't know if I'll still be here a year after we get there, can't imagine. Who knows? We don't always see eye to eye. We have elections to get through. But obviously, I would be personally absolutely pushing for that, and as I say, one of the reasons that's slightly delayed is we have tragically lost the executive director who was responsible for that. With regard to things like developments and so on, I think I said in the written answer, you know, I completely agree. Unfortunately, I don't always get consulted on as to everything that happens in council, but even if I do, it doesn't necessarily mean what I say is taken into account. Obviously, we have the head of planning here who may be able to give some specific information. So I know there's quite a lot of work going on in that department on this issue, so I don't know if she wants to add something. If she does, that's brilliant.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Councillor. I can take you in terms of local plan. I think I'm item 5, and I'm going to be talking through some baseline information that we're working on local plan policy. But that work's already been done. So statutory is part of the local plan. The LPA needs to carry out a sustainability appraisal and a strategic environmental assessment of all policies that it's brought to the Secretary of State. So that work's already undertaken. Years in preparation and support those policies, but particularly in terms of what you're referring to now, moving on following climate change, I am proposing to update what we have is a validation checklist for all planning applications, and that's locally devised here in Liverpool, and we publish that. I'm making a number of alterations to it, but part of that I'm proposing to include climate change report. So every application or every major application, we won't be asking for all applications. So for instance, it might be for residential development over 100 units or something that is going to